Yeah, thank you, Vishwa. Thank you for organizing this wonderful like summer school, and it's good to see so many students interested in processor architecture. So I'll go through this Ryzen processor microarchitecture today. So this is the processor that AMD launched last year. It has like a significant performance improvement over its predecessor, and it's very competitive and doing really well in the market with very good performance feedback from external reviewers. So there are two purposes for this talk. One is to, like, over the last 3-4 days, all of you going through a lot of theory about computer architecture, right? And in the morning, for example, you heard about like coherence and all those things. So here you can able to see how the whole thing comes together in the real life in an industry level processor. So that's one thing that you should be able to take away from this talk. Another thing, if time permits, I'll go over, like, a lot of these things happen in India. So a lot of these kind of interesting works happen in India, and so there are a lot of opportunities. To what kind of work that we are doing here that I'd like to try to highlight that. And so, but another disclaimer is I won't be able to go through a lot of internal details of the processor because of, like, legal issues. We can't reveal those things. So, but anyway, like, if you have any doubts, like, it's like really informal, so you can stop me, ask me questions. I can try to explain as much as I can. Okay, so I work from AMD Bangalore, so we have this microprocessor performance modeling and architecture team which I lead. So there are like a lot of divisions. So our team was involved in this Ryzen microarchitecture from from the very beginning. So Ryzen, it's like the CPU that, like, a new x86 CPU that AMD came up last year. It's a ground up design. So it's like, in processor world, a ground up design is like a big thing. It takes like a lot of years of effort. So a lot of times what we do is we do one design and then incrementally improve it. But this one was like a major change from the previous design. So I'll just quickly go through why we wanted to do that. So what I'll talk about is the agenda. I'll describe like core engine, what is there inside the engine, then this floating point unit, execution unit, those things, the cache hierarchy. Then we have this SMT feature there first time in one of the AMD code came up with like complete simultaneous multi-threading. This Ryzen based some SoCs, I'll just briefly overview that. And then kind of design challenges we face, and that's common, like any, it's not like unique to AMD, but any microprocessor design when you want to do, what kind of challenges you face. And then contribution from India Design Center, and then what we are doing right now. So that's kind of the agenda of my talk. It's slow, actually. Okay. So this is the Ryzen CPU. This is a die shot of the Ryzen CPU. It has two clusters. We call it CPU complex. Like, there are two CPU complexes, and each complex has four cores. Those four cores are called Zen cores. So our chief architect came up with the name Zen because he wanted to come up with this balanced design. So Zen represent that balanced design. This 1, 2, 3, 4. These are the four cores. 5, 6, 7, 8. 8 cores in one die. And these are there are these L2 caches here. These are the L3 caches. This is like really cool. Like, this is like looking at the die shot, you can see all these things. And then in each die, there are around 4.8 billion transistors. It's done with 14 nanometer process technology. And there are over 2,000 meters of wiring to connect all these pieces. So in the externally, like, this is L3 is each CPU, like four cores share this L3. And then externally, you connect through DRAM and other IO devices, and all those connections are in the boundaries. So this is like one CPU complex. So this is one CPU complex. As I said, there are four cores. And so there is each core has its own data cache inside, and instruction and data caches. And then there's a 512 KB 8-way L2 cache. And then there's an 8M L3 cache shared between all four cores. So each core can reach out to any of these slices. So we call it like it's a slice twice. So it's not like, so core 0 can go to this slice, slice 4, or core 2 can go to slice 1, anything. So there is a latency kind of going, little distance is little higher, but overall there's an uniform average latency. So every core can access every cache with same average latency. And this Ryzen CPU, this is the basic building block for any Ryzen-based design. So in case of like Threadripper, that is our high-end gaming, kind of high-end desktop part, so they have like two of these CCX in one die, that die picture I showed. Then we have Epic server, which has this eight of these CCXs. So basically there are 32 cores. And then we have laptop parts where we have just only one CCX, the four core part. Yeah, so why we did a ground up design instead of going through incremental design like we were doing before. So earlier we had these two process lines. One is like low power core called Jaguar core, and one is the high performance core, excavator core. But then what happens is, like, if you want to increase the low power core, performance of the low power core, its power is increasing, so it no longer remains a low power core. And similarly, in the high performance core also, like, we are not able to, like, reach to that high performance with the incremental design. So we had to come up with something brand new. And when we were doing that, we decided that we'll just design one core, which will address from, like, really ultra low power device high performance, like gaming or like desktop designs. All this whole range, we have to come up with a single design. And we have to come up with a significant performance uplift over the existing core. So we started with a target of like, say, 40% higher IPC, but eventually we achieved like a more than 50% higher IPC. So when you're talking IPC is instructions per cycle, the number of instructions you can commit per cycle. So that's what we achieved. So this is like, in this is like the power, and this is like the performance. So this is where Zen landed. So it didn't take more power than the previous excavator core. So we wanted, aim was to do not increase the power, but increase the performance. So that overall, performance is really compelling. So that's what we achieved with the core. Yeah. So that's what, here another diagram for that. So this was our previous high performance core line. This started with this bulldozer core called bulldozer, which was a ground up design. Then incrementally we changed like to pile driver, steamroller, excavator. We incrementally improved the performance. And we at the same time, we reduced its power. So it was like that. Then when Zen came, we wanted to do a significant shift, because with the basic design, you can't do much changes with incremental design. So we did a significant ground up core with more than 50% IPC uplift, but at the same time we kept our power at the same level, so that you spend less energy per cycle. So that was kind of the balanced design we did. So typically what happens in the other processes, power is kind of a priority citizen, like we don't look at power from the beginning of the design. But with Zen, people, like, we looked at power from the very beginning, the power gating, this, like, any features that we are adding, like how it's, what is the power, whether there's a power performance uplift advantage or not, that we looked at. So that way we could achieve like balance and performance without spending a lot of power. So yeah, overall this is kind of a high level summary. So this is a really new high performance core, and this has like high bandwidth, low latency cache system. So simultaneous multi-threading, that's like we added a lot of hardware into it. So to optimize this use of hardware, so to have like high throughput, we used the SMT, added SMT, and then it was designed on this energy efficient process technology. Okay, so now I'll just go to the actual microarchitecture of Zen. Zen is that single core that I showed in the CPU cluster, Ryzen cluster CCX1 core, we call it Zen, along with the L2, L3 part, it's called the Zen core. So I'll just go through the details of that core. So you looked at the basic pipeline, right? So there is this fetch, decode, execute, commit, that's, and any, it's a out of order code. Any code you can think of, it has like this kind of basic steps. So this is the fetch unit. I'll go through the details again later slides. So this is the overall architecture. So this is like this instruction cache. This is a branch prediction which predicts from where you need to bring the next instruction from. And so then this is the decode unit which decodes. And then in Zen, you can bring the instruction either from the instruction cache or there's something called micro-op cache. So you can bring the instruction from there. So, and then the decode unit decodes the instruction. So this AMD designs this x86 cores. x86 instruction set is like a really complex instruction set. So in the cache, what happens is instruction cache, you have this just one, say, line of instruction. It can have multiple instructions in there. There's no fixed, say, that this is the one instruction, this is the another instruction and all. So each instruction have different length. And so that we need to, so decode unit, it's very complex. It has to take that line and then understand where the instruction starts and what this instruction do. And sometimes one instructions you cannot just do with one operation. One instruction may need multiple operations. So we call it micro ops. So one instructions, most of the time we try to break it into one instruction to one op. Sometimes we break it into multiple ops. Now, once you do that hard work, and you, as you know, most of the time instructions kind of, we repeat the same instruction. Say, for example, if we have a loop, the same instructions repeated multiple times. So there's no point in kind of doing it multiple times, right? You, once you decode it, and then you keep it in the op cache. So next time you come, you can just take the decoded instruction directly from the op cache. So this saves both power and improves performance because you save on the decode cycle. At the same time, you improve, you don't have to do the decoding, like that's a power hogging feature, right? So when the branch predictor predicts that, okay, I need to bring my next instruction from, say, this part, this place, so then you look up in your op cache and see whether that is already there in the op cache. If it's there in the op cache, you directly send it here in the micro op cache. If it's not there in the op cache, you go to the instruction cache, which looks it up. If it misses in the instruction cache, you have to go and bring it from L2 or L3 or memory, whatever. And then it decodes, and then you send it to one queue called micro-op queue. And then from the micro-op queue, this is the execution part. We have a separate integer and floating point execution units. So we can send up to, so decode unit can send up to 4 instructions per cycle to micro-op queue. And this micro-op queue can dispatch up to 6 instructions to the integer unit or 4 to the floating point unit. So then if it's a load story, if it's an integer instruction, it gets sent to integer queue and integer pipe and then gets executed here and floating point gets executed here. If there are load store units, then these address generation units generate the address of the load store operations and send it to the load store unit, LS unit. And LS, the data cache resides here in the LS unit. Can you see it? Okay, data cache resides here in the LS unit, so you look up the data cache. If it's there, it's fine. Otherwise, you look up the L2 cache, which is also private. So this L2, this data cache, L2 are all private to this core. And if it's there in L2, that's fine. You get it from L2 to the DC, and then from there to the load store unit, execution unit, and floating point unit. If it's not there, then you send it to L3. And so on. So as I said, there's a large shared L3, that 8M16 way between all 4 cores. And this two-way SMT, which I'll discuss later. So there are like, say, each of these units, there are multiple queues. Say, for example, in the load store unit, there are like 72 out of order loads are supported through these load order queues, load queues. Yeah. Okay, so now next, again, I'll go a little bit deeper into the fetch unit. So, as I said, like fetch unit, you need to know from where to fetch the next instruction, right? So how do you know? So either you know from like the branch predictor tells you, okay, predicts that, okay, this is like take it from this place. But if branch predictor again is not like a single magical structure. It has multiple different types of things. For example, if you have a call return kind of so to predict that correctly, I mean efficiently, we have a return stack. So you can have indirect branches. Like say for example, in your C++ code, you have your virtual function calls. Like that is translates to indirect branches in the program. So for that, we have an indirect target array. So similarly, there's a branch target buffer, which for every branch, it tries to store where the target is. So branch target buffer. And then this is a perceptron-based predictor, which says like where to predict. Again, there are like actually multiple levels of prediction that happens here. So from there, like the branch predictor takes, looks at your current instruction stream prediction and then says where it needs to go next. So that's from where you can get it. The other thing is when you are doing a prediction, at execution time, you need to match whether you what you predicted and what you actually, where you are going is correct or not. For example, you are saying that, okay, if I is less than 0, go in if part and the otherwise go in else part, right? And your predictor says go in the if part. But actually while doing the execution, you're saying I is not less than 0, it's greater than 0. So then you're going to the else part. So that needs to come at the execution time only, you know. And for that, then the execution will say, okay, your branch mispredicted. It will send you a redirect that, okay, start from there again. So that again, it comes from the EX. Similarly, if you have a direct jump, so while decoding, you know that, okay, this is a direct jump. So then from the decode itself, you can say, okay, go to this part. So decode can also send a redirect. So all those redirects comes, your branch predictor tells where to go. So from there, you know this address, where to go. And then you look up the TLB. TLB does the translation from a linear to physical address. So then you look up the TLB, you look up the, then you send this to this physical request queue. You store this in the queue, and from the queue, you look up the instruction cache. So one thing is, when this is again a high performance design, your branch prediction part and this your cache lookup part is kind of decoupled through this queue inside, because then you don't have to kind of go lockstep. Say if your IC instruction cache misses, then your whole branch prediction structure doesn't stall. It can still go on doing the prediction and filling it up this physical request queue. So that way we can decouple this too. And similarly, okay, where is the microphone? So, and yeah, so these are some of the other details, like we have like two branches per BTB entry and all those things, like, yeah. So we fetch 32 bytes of instruction at any point of time. So, and these tags also go to micro op cache lookup. So, yeah, this is the other part of the decode unit. So from this IC, you write those instructions lines in something called instruction byte buffer. And from the instruction byte buffer, you pick up those instruction byte buffers and you decode them through, like, this logic is really complex in x86 because you need to look into that instruction, see where the instruction boundaries are. That's the first challenging thing because each instruction has a different length. And once you identify the instruction boundaries, then you need to understand what instruction there. There's a lot of different encoding happens. So two instructions can look exactly the same, but just depending on one bit of encoding, it means different things. In some case, something is like, okay, this is a register value, and some other case, it means completely different thing based on the encoding. So all those things happens is this decode level, and then decoded things is sent to micro op queue. Similarly, as I explained before, these tags come to op cache, and you look up the op cache. And if it is a op cache hit, then you much earlier you get all those micro op queues and micro ops, and you send it to the op cache or micro op queue. Say, so for our design, we analyze the programs and try to design our op cache such that we get more op cache, micro op cache hits. So that's one of the, we try to make the design so that we get more of these op cache hits because it's much faster. And similarly, some of the micro ops are like, not like one or two ops. They need like a whole routine of ops. We call it microcoded ROM. So there's a stored in this microcoded ROM. So you can look it up also there and from dispatch there. So stack engine is another like optimization feature that we have. For example, a lot of our code has this kind of call returns or like not call return, so like local variables which operates on stack, right? And those, if you want to operate those, so you have to, there's a stack pointer which you keep incrementing and decrementing. So, and if you do that in the EX unit, so there is a dependency got created. So, and we found that you can do it earlier, so that during the execution time, there's no such dependency. So, the stack engine is one such structure. So, throughout the code, I mean, throughout the code, there are such optimizations happen wherever possible to speed up the process. So, every kind of percentage or sub percentage of performance matters when we design these high performance cores. So, stack engine is one such feature that we do, and then you send it to the dispatch unit from there, which goes to the EX or LS or FP units. Yeah. So, say another, say for example, another feature is this branch fusion. So, a lot of times what happens is you have a compare and branch instructions next to each other. So, basically you compare and then like, and then you do the branch based on the compare result. So, instead of doing these two instructions, you can actually dynamically in decode engine can fuse them together as a single instruction. And then just send them as a, from then onwards it's just a single op. The advantage is then like down the line there are all these queues, you just need one scheduler queue, one execution, you just execute as a one op. See, most of the time, the complex ops are broken into like multiple ops. Similarly, here two simple ops are fused by the hardware to another op, create a fused op, and then execute it as a single instruction.
Okay.
Yeah.
Like the stack engine and the perceptron-based branch predictor, the previous
thing. Yeah. Yes.
So, is there going to be more of this in the upcoming?
Yeah, sure. So, a lot of these, if you see high performance code that we design, a lot of these designs come from academic research. All these research ideas we see and then we incorporate into our designs. And it's not like you cannot just put it as it is. We need to do a lot of kind of customization and a lot of changes depending on our needs. So, I'll just talk about this, what kind of design criteria we look at while designing these cores. So, obviously, stack, as you see, I mean, as I go through our whole branch prediction algorithm, there are obviously unique parts, but most of the things are from the research. So, similarly, so our prefetcher ideas, it's not like out of the world kind of thing that we have designed from scratch. So, it's like the whole idea is to take all these pieces, separate pieces, and put it together, come up with a balanced design with the constraints that we have, the area constraint, the power constraint, the transistor budget that we have, and the applications that we look at, and create a design.
Isn't it slightly counterintuitive that your TDP is going down while you are introducing more and more complex and data structure type items in your process? I mean, I get it that that's your USP, but shouldn't it suppose, isn't it supposed to be like,
yeah, so that's the design kind of innovation, right? That how you keep it, like say, for example, we do a lot of power gating, clock gating. So if the structures are not used, you kind of power them down. So that, and then structure the size, I mean, optimize the structure sizes. You don't make it so big that you don't, I mean, you don't need it. So there's all these trade-offs happen continuously during the design phase. Okay, so this is the execution unit. As I said, like 6 micro ops are dispatched from the decode unit to the execution unit. And the first stage of, dispatch is like after dispatch it gets mapped. Basically, your physical registers are mapped into, your architectural registers are mapped into physical registers for like out of order execution. So till this point, it's all in order. So in the retire queue, keep the instructions in order because you need to retire in order. That's kind of one of the fundamental things in any out-of-order processors. The retire, commit, or retire happens in order. So you do all this mapping, and then you send it. So we have 6 execution ALUs, and say 4 ALUs and 2 address generation units. These are arithmetic logic units. So we have 6 separate scheduling queues. So here we decide which op needs to go to which queue, and from there we send it to the corresponding ALU from this ALQ0, it goes to ALU0 and so on. So load stored, the address generation happened, ops go to this address generation queues, AGQ0 and AGQ1, from there it goes here. And these ops, like after the addresses are generated, it goes to the LS unit. And LS unit gets the data and then feeds it back to this ALUs for further operation. So we have this 192 queue, retire queue. It means, what does it mean? It means like we can have till 192, that's the instruction window we can look at and we can reschedule and we can pick up, keep waiting. And so we can operate on two branches per cycle. And then this is another optimization, for example, simple optimization, move elimination. What happens is if you have a register R1 to R2, so instead of actually copying the data of R1 to the data of R2, when you are doing the mapping there, you can just simply map the physical register that was mapping to R1 to map to R2. So architecture register that was mapped to a physical register R1, that was, you can map it to R2, so that it's kind of have the copies same values. So all those kind of optimizations we do throughout the core. And so we dispatch 6, but we do a 8-wide retire. That again we found out through our simulation, through our modeling, that that's the optimum. Because a lot of times, although we execute, we cannot retire something because the older instruction hasn't completed yet. Maybe the older instruction has a cache miss, it's taking longer to execute, but the younger instruction has executed, so it's waiting in the retire queue. So this gets piled up in the retire queue. So then we, that's why we allow 8 instructions to retire at the same cycle. Although we are dispatching 6, you may think why then dispatching 6, executing 6, you may as well retire 6. But a lot of times we cannot retire anything because of older instructions hasn't retired. So, yeah, so this is the load store unit. This is another very complex unit inside the core. So this address generation unit, EX unit that generated the address, right, that comes to this cores, these units. So it's a load queue and stored. Load operations are written into this load queue and stored operations are stored in this stored queue. And from there we pick this address. So this picker is another important thing. It makes this all this out of order execution happen. So it's not like in order, the order it comes, it doesn't go out in that order. So it does that out of order pick here, and then you just, we can execute 2 loads at the same cycle. So there is a 2 load pick happens, and then these loads need to look at the TLBs. So a TLB to do a TLB lookup to do the linear to physical address translation. So these 2 TLB pipes doing the lookup at the same time, and similarly, so then we do the cache lookup. So also we need to do a data tag lookup. So tag and the data are 2 separate arrays basically in the core. It's not like if you have a simplistic view of cache, right, it's a data, there's cache. Some parts is the tag you are storing in the data storing, it's like separate things. And we do a tag lookup and TLB lookup to see whether it's a for load, whether it's a hit or miss. For store also we need to do that, but in for store we do not need to read the data. So we store is fine, just know the hit or miss, because if it's a miss, you need to bring that line. But if it's a hit, you do not need to read the data, you just override the data. So what happens in store, when the stored data is available, you put it in the store commit buffer. And from that store commit buffer, you keep writing into that, in the data cache. And if it's a miss, load store or whatever, so in that case, you write into this called miss address buffer. You store it there, and from there it goes to L2, and the data is come back from L2. And for the store, so what might happen is there's a store and there's a load, and store hasn't written into the data cache yet, right? So, but the load has come, so now if the load has to wait for the store to write and then read the data, there's unnecessary delay, because the data is available, you might as well take from the store to that load. So we do that kind of a forwarding called store to load forwarding, where you send the data from store to load. And what else? So here is like, say for example, there's a lot of times we use data that is not cacheable. So those data is I mean, sent to from the store to the, this called write combining buffered. We send them and then send it to L2. Say for example, you are writing this whole line, 64 byte line, but you are not writing it in at one shot, right? You are writing like small chunks, like 8 byte or 16 byte and so on. So you can combine all of those things here in this buffer and send it as a single write. Here there's a small tiny piece block, it's called prefetch. But it's like really, really performance critical piece in the whole architecture. So have you read about prefetcher in your architecture, these lectures mentioned, hardware prefetcher? So that's this tiny piece here. It's like really critical. So what does prefetcher do? It kind of looks at all the access patterns that are coming into the load store unit, and from there it predicts, right, what is going to happen, what it going to need in the future, and then creates those accesses. So those prefetcher requests are generated here. This is like actually always saying as a small piece, but it's a really big piece of hardware that sits here, which looks up all these load and store addresses and then generates, like predicts what is the patterns going to be, and then try to bring them into the DC. So that's like another very performance critical feature here called hardware prefetcher. So hardware prefetcher is there in LS, it is there in L2 as well, hardware, because there are multiple hardware prefetchers basically. You need like really complex, because not everything is a very straight line as AI, AI plus one, AI plus two, that you can just, if you see AI, AI plus one, you just know that I need to bring AI plus two. There are more complex kind of data patterns. And prefetcher, because memory access is like really expensive, so we want to, we try to hide as much memory latency as possible. That's why we spend a lot of energy into designing the prefetcher. Again, at the same time, you cannot make the prefetcher very aggressive, because if you bring lot of useless data, then what happens, your useful data gets replaced from the cache. That's one thing. Another thing that might happen is like your memory gets really clogged up, a lot of bandwidth, that's very expensive. So then your performance will drop. So it's very critical feature that we need to design carefully, this prefetcher. Okay. So this is the floating point unit. So like execution unit, the similar EX, I mean integer execution, we have a similar floating point execution unit. So there we have this, it can handle up to 4 instruction dispatched to it. And then there's a physical register file mapping, things happen quite similar way. So then there's the other thing is in execution floating point unit, you have 2 queues called, this is a scheduler queue. You remember in the execution unit, we had 6 of these, right? 6 of these separate queues. So, but in floating point unit, we have a single monolithic scheduler queue. But the problem with that is we cannot make it very large. Right, so one thing is in any architecture, you'll be seeing lot of these things like your BTB or branch prediction, you have multiples of them, L1, L2, TLB, L1, L2, BTB, L1, L2 caches. Just because we cannot afford to make a really big structure, making a big structure, it takes longer time to access it, which we cannot afford. So there we have to critically balance like how much, what's the max we can, the given time we can access, so we really keep those hot information in that smaller structure and then make a bigger backup structure. Similarly here, scheduler queue, if you make it really big, then what happens is it will take longer time to look through this queue and pick up things that you can execute. So what we do is we break it into 2 parts. SQ is the schedulable queue where we look it up and schedule for execution, and then there's an NSQ, that non-schedulable queue. So where do you keep things? So if this queue is empty and there's space, the dispatch ops directly go here. But if it's not empty, then it goes here, but we don't look it up here in the NSQ unless there's a space here, and then we move from NSQ to SQ. So the other thing that it helps is like, what we say is our design is back pressure. So once, say for example, this queue is full and this queue is full, you cannot dispatch anything. And since dispatch is in order, so if the FP dispatch gets stuck, then your execution EX unit also gets stuck, right? It cannot, because dispatch needs to happen in order. Is that clear? So all those things, like you need to kind of balance the design. Here we need to see like, okay, now how many entries can we afford to spend here so that our execution, other units don't get stalled. Okay, so that's the floating point unit. Next is the cache hierarchy. So we talked about the till the DC point, right? So if once the instruction cache or data cache misses, so the request comes to the L2 cache. This is the instruction cache, this is the data cache, and from there the request come to this L2 cache. So this the prefetcher, there could be demand request or there could be prefetch requests. Both come to this data cache, L2 cache. This is 512 KB L2 cache. This is unified for instruction and data. It's a 8-way. And from there, if it misses the L2, then it goes to the L3. L3 is shared between other cores. So basically, this core 0, similarly core 1, 2, 3, 4, all accesses this L3 cache. So there is some interconnection network that runs between this L2, all these L2s and the L3. So the other thing is this L3 is a victim cache. So what does it mean? Victim cache means when this you miss the data, miss the cache here, so you bring the data from the memory, but then you don't write the data here. You write it directly to L2, and L3 is only populated by the victims from L2. That's why. So what advantage is that with that is like you get a higher kind of capacity. So your total capacity becomes like this is 8M and then 4512K, that's like 10 meg, because you do not replicate the data. Some data gets replicated, so we don't say it's like completely exclusive, but it's mostly exclusive L2 and L3. So then the disadvantage is if you have a completely inclusive cache, the advantage is if some from the outside, like today you heard about the cache coherence protocol, right? So from the outside, if some coherence comes, so L3 could easily answer that, okay, I mean, because it has all the copies of data that other L2L and DC and L2 has, but now it's mostly exclusive. So those probes, it has to pass it to the lower level to get the response from, and it has to do some kind of filtering. It has to know, so we have some ways to know which data is where, and then send the probes accordingly to filter it out. We can't kind of blindly send everything everywhere, so we try to optimize that. So that's, and then for example, we have some efficient way to cache to cache transfer. For example, you have a core 0 wants some data, and that data is not in L3, but it's in core 1's L2. So that we can kind of send efficiently. Similarly, it could be in another complex wants some data. It comes to this complex cache, and it has to get the data from there. So we have all this coherence level optimization, probe optimization, all those things happens to send the data fast. And so also we send this, as I said, all these miss address buffers to keep the L1 and L2 misses. So those are there to have like large outstanding number of misses here and still move forward. Similarly, the way we have prefetch at the LS level, we also have a prefetch at the L2 level. Data prefetch, because L2 is larger, so we can afford to bring more data into L2. Okay, so which? No, that's what I explained. It's mostly exclusive. I would say not completely exclusive, but mostly exclusive. There are certain conditions on which where L2 data will be staying in both at L2 and L3. But most of the time it's exclusive, so that we get maximum maximum space utilization. Yeah, so again, I'm just revisiting the whole. So far we just talked about this Zen core, and this is the shared L2, and I just explained, right? This is the 8M L3 that each core accesses. This is the Zen core, all this like fetch, execute, whatever I explained, this resides in these pieces. So yeah. So this is another important feature that we added, and it's an again very complex feature support that we added in Zen is a simultaneous multi-threading. So did you hear about simultaneous multi-threading in any of these classes before here? Okay. So what simultaneous multi-threading does is, I mean, you can actually execute two threads on the same hardware in parallel. So because what happens is, like, if you see, like, all we have the all these large queues and all this large lot of hardware we put in, right? But sometimes what happens is in the program that you are running, it may not have even have enough parallelism. So to utilize all of this hardware. For example, we can commit 8 instructions, right, or dispatch 6 instructions. So ideally, we should get, at least in the best case scenario, we can get 6 instructions per cycle, like execute, commit, 6 instructions per cycle. But that doesn't happen because, like, there are a lot of dependencies, there are cache misses, there are branch mispredictions happening inside the core. So we get lot lower IPCs. Now, what do you do with all the other so much of hardware staying there, right? If you can execute multiple threads, which they are completely independent and all, but they can share the hardware. So in that case, you will like more effective use of the hardware, and you can also get overall number of instructions executed, committed more. That's called throughput computing, and that is very important. Say, for example, like a lot of servers kind of benchmark, so they try to all the data centers, cloud computing, so where they try to run as many applications as possible or get as many instructions done per cycle, right? Not a single thread. There are two kind of things when we look at the performance of a processor. One is a single thread performance, how fast your single application can run. That is called single thread performance. Another thing is like how many instructions you can execute. It may not be from the single application. It can be from multiple applications. That's called throughput computing. So SMT gives you that ability to do throughput computing. Yeah, the concept is the very same, but the implementation is different. So I don't know about the internals of the Intel's implementation, of course. Yeah, so it's the same kind of concept, hyper-threading. So, so we have this whole front-end structure that I showed about. So there, all these things are competitively shared. Competitively shared means, like, if one thread needs more, it will get more. So it's not like I'm statically partitioning, saying that, okay, you can get only half of the IC and other thread is going to get only other half of the IC, nothing like that. So this is all kind of competitively shared. Whoever needs more will get more. And so that's most efficient, basically. And then there are few structures that we are statically partitioned. And mostly we statically partition because of implementation issues, maybe doing it for, dynamically partitioning was giving like more complex, adding more complexity or design complexity. So that's the most of the time, that's why we statically partition some of the queues. And also there are like, although we are saying that you can get as much as you want, but then we also try to do some, we do round robin like scheduling policies, then we do some kind of watermarking in some cases, some kind of fairness, because we don't want once thread to starve completely while other thread goes ahead. So some kind of parity needs. So there are some thread switching. So we do a lot of this experimentation with thread switching policies, fairness policies, thread fairness policies, and all to come up with the optimum design points for, to do all those things. So so that's like the SMT, the two-way SMT we got in Zen. So overall, that's like the Zen microarchitecture. So that we achieved the better core engine. So we have this. So we improved like our branch prediction significantly from our previous excavator core and this op cache. So all these things, just talked about, right? Larger instruction scheduler, we increase this. So one thing is this kind of IPC improvement doesn't come for free. So more IPC improvement you need to burn more area, put more transistor in, like increase bigger structures and all those things. So the whole key is how to use them efficiently, how to design your structures optimally so that you get the best use of all your structures. So these are all those changes we have done. Like, say, for example, in a previous design, there was like retire queue 128. We moved it to 192. So we did a study saying 256 would be even better. But then, of course, we can't afford 256. Then we have to I'm sorry, move that move instruction elimination. Say, for example, you have R1 to R2 move, right? So instead of actually moving the data from R1 to R2 while doing the register mapping, you just map the architecture register to the physical register of R2, change the mapping so that it becomes that value, right? So instead of copying the actual data, you just copy the pointer. Yes. Sorry. So, so write back L1 cache again is a like better design than we our previous design has write through cache, which had a lot of problem. So we just move back to write back L1 cache. So L1 and L2 are inclusive. So whatever is in L1 is in L2 as well. So we achieved like faster L1 and L2 heat latencies, and then we increase the L3 bandwidth and those things. So and the power side, I mean, there's this aggressive clock gating, as I mentioned, is done from the very beginning, and then there is this. All these features, and there are like tons of other features, basically, which used, for power optimization. Okay. So these are some of the Ryzen-based SoCs. The first and foremost is the EPYC server. So as I said, there are like four dies, basically, in an EPYC server, 1P server. So each die has 2 CCX. Right, and each CCX has 4 cores. So if you do the maths, this is 8 cores here. So there are total 32 cores, 32 cores, 64 threads. Each core has 2 threads in it, so 64 threads. And then you have this from one CCX to other CCX, you have this connection called, you call it infinity fabric. So this is, each CCX is connected to other CCX. From one, each die is connected to the other die. And from this die, you also have this connected to DDR. So as Mainak showed, like there could be home nodes and then like all the structures, if you just recall, so you can map it to there. Like, so locally, it's like shared multiple levels of memory. So when you are coming from other CCX, so this CCX view is like from the coherency point of view, what is there in L3? It doesn't care which core has what. To him, that L3 is the boundary, like which CCX has it. Now L3 needs to find out who has what. So that's like multiple levels of coherence. So the coherency protocol that we implement has like something that we do at like L3 level something, L2 has maybe some finer grains and so on. So overall the protocol is the same, but then we have multiple granularity we maintain. And from the outside view, it's like what the CCX has. It doesn't care, I mean, inside the CCX, who has at what state and all those things. So this is like the IOS connected and all. So for example, so as I said, like with the same core, we went to different, went to this ultra low power, then the server, desktops, and all those things. So for example, so server, the important features are support for virtualization, support for security, ECC, and these are targeted for the data centers. And then the other one, say, so we have these desktops which are like really high performing at a higher frequency. It operates at a much higher frequency because the Threadripper desktop, because their power is not such a big bottleneck, so we can move it at the higher frequency. And there we want to get like as much performance as possible from the gaming and other stuff. Say again, when you look at like low power client laptops, so client applications don't need that much of L3 cache. They don't need, they said, I don't care about 8 meg L3, our applications are happy with 4 meg L3. Because I mean, they're just one CCX and, but area is really important. So they cut down on the L3 size. But they are very kind of aggressive on the power optimization because on the laptops, battery life, power, they are really important. So then, those are the different design points. So Zen has to kind of serve to that also. So all those kind of features are designed in the one core itself. And then there are like these variants. Similarly, I mean, we work with SCBU also, like semi-custom business units. So each SCBU client has come up with their different criteria. So in the past, AMD processors like Jaguar, low power processors has gone to game consoles like Xbox and PlayStation. So they come up with their own criteria again. So we have to customize the core according to all the CPU customers. So okay, I'll just quickly, I think we're just almost running out of time. So I'll quickly go through, how much time do I have? 10 minutes, okay, thanks. Yeah, so I'll go through some of the design challenges we face. So one thing is this designing these high performance cores are like really time consuming thing. And it takes like multiple years, like 3-4 years is like a really good time if you can design a core ground up from design to market in 4 years, that's like really impressive achievement. And there's like this hundreds of engineers work for 4 years over this project. And but the problem is some of the key design decisions we need to make really early in the design. And then we need to stay for 4 years with that. Say for example, in the beginning of the process, we are kind of have some estimate of now how much area we have, how many transistors we can get, because the fab is at the same time, so this is also this is on 14 nanometer. So while we are designing it, so 14 nanometer process is also kind of developing in the fab. So they gave us some ideas about how much power it will burn the transistors, how much leakage will be there, what area, what's the size. And with that in the mind, we started designing things. We took the decisions. Now things change along the line. And sometimes what happens is what kind of we thought like, okay, in 4 cycles we can reach from point A to point B, but then towards the end they say, oh no, it won't take 4 cycles, it'll take 5 cycles, I need to add more cycles there, and then your performance go down, then again you try to optimize something else somewhere else. So these kind of things keep happening. So there are key design decisions you need to take very early, assuming things will go well. So, and a lot of times there are things that go in a different direction, you need to kind of adjust that. That's I find is very challenging. So keeping the area and power under control, because as you go in the design, like over 4 years, a lot of things changes. And then so by the time you complete your design, your technology should be available to make it. So these two things need to come together at the same point. And so they are independently developing things. And because when you are doing the circuits and all those feedback needs to come from the fab, that what it takes. So that's one of the challenging thing. And then other thing is like we have this one core going to multiple SoCs and each has a very conflicting design needs that we need to address. For example, server needs like bigger last level cache, the multi-thread performance throughput is really important for server more than single threaded performance. On the desktop, 1T performance is more important. For example, I said like this, prefetcher is a classic example. You can get a really good single threaded performance by going very aggressive prefetcher. But when you have multiple threads running together, your memory becomes a bottleneck and you cannot do a really aggressive prefetching. So then your performance will hurt. So you need to come up with a balance point where you kind of lose your single thread performance too much. At the same time, you don't penalize your multi-threaded performance as well, throughput computing. And similarly, the clients are like very area and power sensitive. So they don't like bigger caches. They don't, but they would say rather say give us smaller area, that's more value for us. So semi-custom, they want like different ISA supports. So all these things need to be adjusted. So another very important thing is workloads to consider. What workloads shall we look at while designing? Because you take like 4 years, like by the time you come to market, maybe some other workload is more important, some other kind of your program characteristics have changed. So a lot of design decisions we took in Zen and now it's coming like, okay, oh, you should have done that. You should have done that. So, but 4 years back when we were designing it, we went to the customers, no one said like what they wanted. Now they're saying, oh, I wish you had that feature. So those kind of things keep happening. So you need to kind of see what is going to be important after 4 or 5 years, because this design is to stay for, we are not designing a new, brand new core every year, every 2 years, or even not every 4 years. So once you design, it needs to stay for like 6-8 years, and you build upon that base design, right? So that needs to be very carefully done so that you can build on that, you can extend that, whatever learning you have from your design decisions, you can incorporate it in the future cores. Sometimes those things don't come on time, So you cannot, oh, I wish it had come like 6 months back. I could have just put it in the last moment. So those kind of things keep happening. But anyway, that's, you have to. And then the other thing is most importantly, competitiveness. Like, our competition is not also staying idle, right? So when 4 years, 5 years back, we started designing, we need to kind of foresee what the, where the competition would land up. So we have to do that prediction and try to match that performance. So those, all these things make this design really challenging, but at the same time, very exciting. So that's kind of really fun part of it. No. It's more like business specific. So data centers and clients like, say, Google, Facebook, they want one kind of workloads. But if you go to some like laptops market, they need different Microsoft like Excel. You speed up Excel and someone will, say, you speed up search engine, something like that. Someone wants to speed up search engine, someone else wants to speed up Excel, or someone wants to have a like really extreme gaming experience. Yes. 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 So, yes, yes, that's what I'm saying, this, all this workload. So we have this workload suite for maybe 4,000 traces or 10,000 traces we have from server to client to like games. Then there are standard benchmarks like spec benchmarks, there are spec server benchmarks. So all those standard benchmarks we analyze, we have our like performance, Kanishka will talk about it more tomorrow in details. So we have our like tools through which we analyze them. We have our cycle accurate simulator to simulate all this code beforehand so that we know exactly how this will behave. So all those things we do, so we, that's the balancing act we do. Like, so you add a feature which helps your server performance a lot, but then it adds your area and it's not helping your client performance, right? So then you try to kind of come up with a balance point. So all those things we do, yes. So looking at the workload analysis is very important. So 52% that we mentioned, that came from the spec CPU 2006 benchmark suite, because that was the, like given to us in the beginning as like, and but then in, across a lot of benchmarks, we got even higher performance, right? It's not like, there are obviously a whole range of performance, but overall we get like lot good performance. But that particular one was like based on spec numbers. Okay, so the last thing I'll say, so a lot of this interesting work happened in India, right? So it's not like somewhere in AMD, US, somewhere did something. So I just wanted to highlight this. So we have a very strong performance modeling workloads team in India. So all those like talk about design feature evaluation, performance modeling to see how the code will behave before actually silicon comes back. So that happened in India. So I was like involved in it from the very beginning, like doing the whole cache hierarchy design, working with the RTL designers on the cache hierarchy side, the L2, L3 prefetcher design. And a lot of this cache memory interaction we worked on, optimized those parts. And as Kanishka is here, he led he leads the all the server workload analysis effort. And, and similarly, we have a client workloads team do this, all this analysis. And then a lot of functional verification happened for the core and the data fabric at the SoC level. Functional verification happens in India. And then some RTL development and some of the SoC architecture, and the whole compiler team also sits in India, because a lot of performance we get from the compilers. The compiler needs to be aware of the architecture. And then so in GCC, in LLVM, all those compilers, we put like our architecture specific optimization so that we get a lot of performance improvement. That happens here, like the whole team sits in India and they do a fabulous job of optimizing performance. I think right now for Zen FP performance, we have some kind of world record, right, in throughput. Yeah, spec scores, as spec 2017, right? So that happens in India. And right now what we are working on, so then the follow-up core Zen 2, which also we heavily worked on, that's hardware is back in the lab with 7 nanometer process with significant performance uplift. So we are working on that, like looking at the performance, seeing that what, I mean, what kind of tuning, what kind of problems are there. So that's what we are working on. And then follow up of Zen 2, that's like in the design phase right now, that's also we are working on. So we do a lot of microarchitectural ideas and exploration for future cores, a lot of things that you see in the academic research, we look at it, we do similar stuff also, I mean, those kind of things like die stacking or like there's that SCM, like storage class memory or quality of service or even like better branch predictor, better cache replacement policies, all those kind of things we do in our teams. And then we do a lot of performance bottleneck analysis, and then how the simulation kind of framework, because another thing is simulation these kind of large machines with this large benchmark is like really challenging. So Kanishka will talk about it in more details. So all those things we do here, and the workload analysis, so those kind of lot of stuff I do here. So lots of challenging problem that we work on. So yeah, that's all I had. Okay, yeah, thank you. Any question? I'm sorry? It's done using register renaming. It's not, register renaming is a vast thing, right? It does lot of like, register renaming is done for out of order execution because your architecture, you are doing speculative paths. So you have multiple copies of the say, like R0 means different things at different point in your program. So for that you need like architecture register, large architecture register set, and you do register renaming to support that. But move elimination is done through register renaming. It's not like the same thing. Any other question? Okay, I'm not allowed to talk about Spectre and Meltdown. These are like security issues. And definitely we are not as impacted as like you read from internet with some of those variants. There are a lot of variants and we are not as impacted, and now the patches are in. So if needed, I can explain like later what Spectre is, but yeah, and how, why we are not, basically to just give a very high level overview, like what happens is we do speculative executions, right? And in the TLBs, you know which thread is accessing this address. Now what happens sometimes in speculative execution, if you, without checking which thread is addressing this, this is a TLB miss, but without even checking which thread is accessing, needs this data, you just let the data go, let that request go and the data come back to the cache, then there are a lot of tricks you can do to some other malicious thread to use that data. So that's kind of is done. But we are not as impacted as we, like we are, people make you to understand, believe, so yeah. So that, I mean, so there are a lot of like security, and after that obviously there's a renewed focus on security, so a lot of these speculation things, I mean, yeah, that we, now we, whenever we propose some new ideas, the thing in mind is it secure enough. Yes. Then again you split it, right? There's a register mapping happens. Now when you are like, again, when you say writing to R1, right? So before that you have a new register mapping happens and you write to R1 then. Only till you just read, so then you do that. And then other things, for example, we do is like when you are mapping, you checkpoint this. This is not related. Basically, that I didn't explain. So basically what happens is when you have a false, comes, you detect there's a branch misprediction, you have to flush the pipeline. Flushing the pipeline means you, and flushing the all the speculative mapping you have done, right? You have to go back to your previous mapping. And that you can do, like you keep checkpointing your mapping at some point so that you go to a fast, to another kind of consistent point. So those kind of things we do.
One quick question. If you focus on security or design and things like that, how has that affected the time to market in design side?
No, no, no. So a lot of these securities are because of flawed hard software, but they put it on the hardware that you have to make it secure. So that's kind of, it's like which lobby is stronger, basically. So, I mean, if the browsers won't fix their problem, rather like push the hardware to, okay, fix it, because we'll have like, we'll allow the malicious code to run. That's kind of. Yeah, I know. Yes. The APUs are their accelerated processing unit with, yeah. Yes. It's not a design choice, it's kind of, you have all the options, right? So if you like, you do like really high-end gaming, then you need discrete GPUs. So that's why you have the option of like having a separate CPU, having a separate GPU, and kind of you get the best class GPU that you want to buy, and the CPU, and you combine, you make your own, you want to? Yeah, Raven-based APU, which has? Yes, that has like APUs, right? And but then again, you have multiple different APUs. You have Vega, and you have some other APUs also combined, and yeah. Yeah, it can. If there are like, they kind of map to the same prediction table, it can mess up. But then that's the thing, like you see, you design it such way there are some hashing functions, or you design it such way that it doesn't mess up. Or you size your table, you size your, you design your hashing function in such a way that it shouldn't mess up that much. I don't know for sure. No, seriously, I don't know, because I don't work on the branch prediction. Yes?
Could you elaborate on the perceptron
which
you use for branch prediction?
I don't know much, because I don't work on the prediction side. But obviously, you know, like hash perceptron, there's a famous paper, I mean, and it was a kind of variant of that, that much I can say. It's, that was the basic of the concept, but then there are a lot of changes happened, because like we look at our branch, I mean, the workloads that we have and what works, what doesn't work based on that. So it's kind of way. I can't give you the details of that, sorry. Yeah, but again, like these are all, what I can say, these are all came from academic research, and then we changed, modified it to according to our workloads and our needs. It's like, so yeah, it's not like, say for example, the simple LRU, it's implementing it is very difficult. I don't know whether anyone implements like just a LRU just like that in the caches or not. So there are like variants of that. I won't identify one piece, because that's why we come up with a brand new architecture. So we threw away our old simulator also, that we don't want to look at that simulator and put it anything on that. So we came up with our like, just except like trace reading part, everything was a new, because we didn't want to be kind of stuck with our old parts. So it, I would say it's like more like we wanted to do something like really high performing, and looking at our current designs, we saw that there's no way we could improve it like significantly. Like we can only put like 5%, 6%, which is not enough. So that's why we started from scratch. Yeah, so it was, I wouldn't say like branch prediction is the only point of like prefetcher or caches, these are the, but the sake of the cache design, it was completely kind of new. We didn't even think about what the old caches were doing. Okay, yeah, thank you.